FM Rainbow.
Fascinating journeys, inquisitive travelers, motivating stories. Interested? Tune into Inspire every second and fourth Saturday at 7 p.m. on 101.3 FM Rainbow.
Musically yours, Akashwani FM Rainbow. Musically yours.
That's right, 7323 seconds on our studio clock. Welcome to Inspire. The clue that I dropped during 5 to 6 and 6 to 7 was our guest today is a gynecologist and a social activist. How does she manage? Well, we'll find out now from Dr. Meenakshi Bharath. Honored to have you here, ma'am. Good evening and welcome to Inspire.
Thank you very much, Rashmi, for giving me this opportunity of speaking on your program. I'm delighted. Good evening, listeners. It's a pleasure to be here with you.
The norm of the show, ma'am, is I don't introduce my guest. You introduce yourself.
All right. Basically, I've been a gynecologist and a doctor for the last 25, 30 years. And over the last 8 years, I've suddenly found that this passion of mine to do something good for the community has been overcoming me. And for those of you who know me, I started as a volunteering an hour or two a week. And now my volunteering means that I'm actually dedicating the better part of my day. If I catch up with 6 hours of sleep a day, I'm delighted because that's the maximum I'd get. But to actually work with all of you, meet, any number of new people. Today I've met Rashmi. It's such a pleasure to have so many nice friends and to do something for all of you which would benefit the community at large is what is my, mission in life, to improve the quality of life for everybody. And I think each one of us who has been privileged to have a good education, to have good nutrition, to have good health, must actually begin to work for the community. Because if we can raise the standard of living for the whole community, the standard of living of everybody in this country will come up. So I think it is our duty, those who are, born fortunate, must take care of those who are not born as fortunate as us. And I think that it is but us who can make the difference. So if we want to change the system, because we are all upset with the way the politics is run, we are all upset that there are potholes and there is, what is due to us is not reaching us. Well, folks, let you and I all get together, be like a strong broom and clean up the society so that we have a wonderful society where you and I feel safe, where you and I get everything that we are entitled to, where we are not greedy but take care of the needs of us and everybody around us. I think it's in your hands to do it. Will you join me? Will you be inspired to be the change that you want to see? That's what I'm asking you for. Let's all join hands together and bring about a new India that we are very proud of and a new India that we'd love to live in. So therefore, I'm calling upon all of us Indians who have gone abroad, all of us Indians who have specialized, come back, bring your professionalism into India and let us use our professionalism to change the way the politics is run, to change the way our city is run, to change the way our homes are run, so that everybody has a square meal, more than a square meal a day. Everybody has an opportunity for good education. Everybody has an opportunity for clean and good living, and everybody is healthy. That's my mission in life, to actually give this to each one of you to the best of the ability that I have in my hands.
Wow. Okay. Now, that's actually a very big mission. To change from what you were doing to what you're doing now, Doctor, it has been a huge journey, I'm sure, for you. But where did it all start? Are you a Bangalore-bred person, completely born and brought up in Malleshwaram? Or were you elsewhere in India and you moved to Bangalore? How did it all start?
Well, I was born in Bangalore, born in St. Martha's Hospital. That's where I studied also. I have lived now for maybe 20, 25 years of my 55 years in Malleshwaram. For a good 20 years, I was out of the country. I was in the Middle East, Dubai and Muscat. But when I came back to India in 2000, primarily with the mission of staying with my parents and taking care of them because they were not getting any younger. My parents and my parents-in-law, they were not getting any younger. And I also wanted my children to grow up in India because, you know, from the time they were born, they were in the Middle East. And I believe that Middle East is neither America nor India. We are somewhere in the middle. We are in the middle.
Yeah.
And so I wanted my children to actually grow up with my parents and in-laws and imbibe the culture of what grandparents, the stability that they bring in. So that is why we came back in 2000, and somewhere after I settled down, I found that, you know, the community was there, and I plugged into the community. I met Ramesh Ramnathan, and he told me, do you know how the country, you know, the city is governed? I didn't know anything about it. I only knew Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha. I knew that there was a state assembly, but I never thought about how is the city run. And then I started plugging into it, and I found that slowly from an hour a week, I, you know, got more and more involved. And that involvement actually got me a lot of joy. And, well, I don't see why I should not do something that I'm so delighted, so happy to do. So slowly it grew on me. And from one to another, we went on. And now I find that doing, helping out the people who are not as fortunate as us gives me enormous joy.
Okay. No, I understand that perfectly, Doctor. But how did you get into this? Like, why did you even think of making a difference in this city? Because there are a lot of us who move from other parts of the world back to Bangalore City. Yes, one main reason is closer to parents, grandparents, children grow up a lot better and with a lot of stability, like you said. But what in you prompted you, or what in the city prompted you to even think of making a difference to the world around you?
I don't know, when my professor, Dr. A. Rajshekar, met me and I told him that I'm doing all this, he says, this is not new. This is something that you've been doing for ages. So when I look back at my life, when I was in my final MBBS, I decided that I must do something. So I became the mess secretary of St. John's Medical College because I said I must improve the food that is being given to the students. So when I look back now, I did it when I was 22.
Okay.
And then when I was doing my MD and my DGO in Davangere, when I was working in the labor room, the labor rooms were dirty. Government hospital labor rooms, you know, is dirty. So I picked up a broom, bought some acid, started cleaning the labor rooms and the bathrooms. And the ayahs used to find it so funny because the doctor was doing it. And so they would come with their brooms and clean it up. So when Dr. Rajshekar said, reminded me, he said, you were doing it then. You're not doing anything new now. For working for the betterment of the community is something that has always been at the back of your mind. Maybe now that everything, you know, your whole... you know, family is done with, and you are still young and healthy and active. This has come to the fore, and well, you've taken it up in a big way.
Okay. No, because the first song that you've asked in the playlist is Main Zindagi Ka Saath Nibhata Chala. Is that a replication of what you have been doing with your life?
Yeah, I think, you know, I believe that whatever comes my way, let me do it with passion. Let me do it with whichever way. And this is one of my favorite songs.
Okay, so we listen to that first. For those of you tuned in late, with us in the studios for Inspire, the inspirational Dr. Meenakshi Bharath.
मैं जिंदगी का साथ निभाता चला गया हर फिक्र को धुएं में उड़ाता चला गया हर फिक्र को धुएं में उड़ा बर्बादियों का सोग मनाना फजूल था बर्बादियों का सोग मनाना फजूल था मनाना फजूल था बर्बादियों का जश्न मनाता चला गया बर्बादियों का जश्न मनाता चला गया हर फिक्र को धुएं में उड़ा कदर समझ लिया जो मिल गया उसी को मुकदर समझ लिया मुकदर समझ लिया मुकदर समझ लिया जो खो गया मैं उसको भुलाता चला गया जो खो गया मैं उसको भुलाता चला गया हर फिक्र को धुएं में उड़ा गम और खुशी में फर्क न महसूस हो जहां गम और खुशी में फर्क न महसूस हो जहां न महसूस हो जहां न महसूस हो जहां मैं दिल को उस मकाम पे लाता चला गया मैं दिल को उस मकाम पे लाता चला गया मैं जिंदगी का साथ निभाता चला गया हर फिक्र को धुएं में उड़ाता चला गया
Welcome back. You're tuned into 101.3 FM Rainbow's Inspire. For those of you tuned in late, with us this hour is Dr. Meenakshi Bharath. In conversation with her is me, Rashmi Shetty. An honor to be sitting on this seat today because talking to her itself is so much of energy that she's passing on. But I have a very practical question to ask you, Doctor. Being a gynecologist definitely is a very lucrative profession. I can't believe that you came from the Middle East to Bangalore City and decided to move away from such a profession.
I don't know how it happened. I think it just happened automatically. I seem to have veered away. Yes, I know. Not only as a gynecologist, but as an infertility person, I can actually make a lot of money. But somewhere I found that making the money was not important. For me, some of Gandhi's principles became very, very big. There's enough for everybody's need, but not enough for everybody's greed. And I didn't see any reason why I needed to earn more than what I required. And even my medical practice, I actually try and help as many poor patients as possible, whoever comes up to my door. There have been people that I have actually given medicines without taking money, and they have come back after 2 years and with their twin babies and returned the money to me for the treatment that I gave. But I think it's all of us need to do this, because if we don't, anyway, how much can I eat? I can eat 3 meals a day. I can wear X number of saris. There are 2X number of saris that are sitting in the cupboard that I haven't worn for the last so many years. And I think that, the karma that I do would actually, in the long run, not only benefit others, but benefit everybody around me. And I think that my grandmother and, my grandfather gave so much to the community and to people who were less fortunate than their own children. They treated everybody like one. And I remember my grandmother used to sit us all around as grandchildren, and she used to give that gukku. Mm-hmm. Everybody got the same amount of food. Okay. So there was never any greed that she gave. There was always give, mm-hmm. and give away. And I think maybe now I find that characteristic of my grandmother and my mother and my parents is becoming alive in me, and that I like to give. And I remember my dad to be very, and as a young 6-year-old, I remember him turning around and saying every time he came home from leave as an army officer, he would spend money on his father's house to take care of his siblings, to up the standard of their life. And he always contributed a portion of his income to add to the income of his father, so that everybody would live with a better standard of living. And I think this is what actually defines that I was brought up to care, to give, and to share, not just keep it for myself. And that's a wonderful feeling that I get when you give. So I think that's where this has all come. So giving to the community now, helping them out in their moment of trouble or distress, actually gives me great joy. So if somebody calls me up at any point of the time and says, come, I need your help, well, I just jump into the car and go. So the contention is I jump into the car. Well, sometimes one has to reach faster than you can do on your two legs.
So you have your sense of humor intact as well. Okay, coming back to what you're doing now, have you, how much time in a day of 24 hours, how much time do you give for gynecology at all? Do you give any time or have you put it on your back burner as in maybe weekends or something like that?
Yeah, a doctor's life is never any, time. And to me, many of my patients come in on a weekend because it is more convenient for them to come in on a weekend. For me, every day is a working day. It doesn't matter to me. Saturday or Sunday is of no consequence. Of course, my family grumbles that I'm not around for them, for which I say that if you want me and want me to do something, then tell me and I will, get off my current jukebox and come back and spend some time with you. So it's only when my children or my parents ask that I actually relax and have a holiday. Like yesterday, when I came home at 8:30, I found that my husband and his two friends, classmates, were there. So I actually didn't do any work for the next 2 hours and I relaxed and had a chat and a giggle with them. But that doesn't happen very often nowadays. My whole day is virtually spent on what shall I do next? What do I need to do? But I feel very energized by it. And of course, I get a good 5 hours of sleep. And then somebody turned around and said, this 5 hours enough? Well, I catnap somewhere in the middle. And that's about it. I think there's enough of, catnapping that gets done, which charges me up. So it's very nice to actually do something for others without expecting any gain for yourself. So I completely
understand. When you set out to do this difference in society around you, do you remember one of the first things that you did wherein you got somebody to come and speak to you and give you a direct feedback of what difference you've made on their lives?
I don't know. I've had some of my patients come back and tell me, and many do come back and say that, you've transformed my life. And of course, I tell them, you're getting pregnant, you're asking for trouble. You're asking for trouble and, your life will get completely transformed and you won't have a moment for yourself. And they come back later on and say, Doc, what you told me was true. I actually lived a very comfortable life and now it's uncomfortable. But the joy of seeing my baby is really the thing that keeps me. And there are many who have come back and said, because I like to counsel them away from the fear of having treatment. There is so much fear in the society on everything, including civic affairs. You're scared to go to the government office. You're scared to go and meet the policeman.
True.
They're all human beings. Somewhere they seem to have a power over the common ordinary man. And I think that is the fear that we need to remove. If we remove these fears, then all of us would be, as a society, live very comfortably. And then if people stop wanting more than what they need, then everybody would be happy, Why is it that we all need to amass and take? Where are we taking when we die? We can't take anything, So we'll all become Tutankhamuns if we amass and amass and amass. Instead, give. The more you give, the more you get. So he also tells students that if you share your knowledge, the knowledge actually increases. So we've got to stop having this crab mentality that we all Indians seem to have of pulling each other down instead of pushing everybody up. So if each one of us practices this, then I think we will have such a beautiful society. So let's all work for it. I'm sure each one of you who is listening can actually plug out a few hours a week to do something good for your neighborhood. And if you start solving problems for your neighborhood, then you automatically become a leader of some sort. People will come up to you and seek your help. And as you do more things, you will learn to solve more problems. And that is what is very important for all of us. If we have a problem less society or a less problematic society, then we would all be
much
living
more
much
happier.
Happier.
That is very true. Now, next on the playlist, you've asked for this track from Nagarhau. Any particular reason? Because it's a really old film.
I know, it brings back memory of my childhood, of the lovely Malleshwaram that was there, that of, you know, the beautiful tree-lined avenues, the quiet, the solitude, and also of a Karnataka that I thought was really nice, those little tepa boats that were there in the movie. I have such lovely memories of it, and I think this song brings back beautiful memories of childhood.
Okay, so with us this are Dr. Meenakshi Bharath in conversation with Rashmi.
Bare bare chandada chelulina tare bare bare valavina chilumega dhari ಸನ್ನಿಯ ಸ್ವಾಗತ ಮರೆಯಲಾರೆ ಚಂದುಟಿ ಮೇಲಿನ ಪೂನಗೆ ಮರೆಯಲಾರೆ ಕಣ್ಣಿನ ಸನ್ನಿಯ ಸ್ವಾಗತ ಮರೆಯಲಾರೆ ಚಂದುಟಿ ಮೇಲಿನ ಪೂನಗೆ ಮರೆಯಲಾರೆ ದ ಹೆಣ್ಣಿನ ನಾಚಿಕೆ ಮರೆಯಲಾರೆ ಮೌನ ಗೌರಿಯ ಮೋಹದ ಕೈ ಬಿಡಲಾರೆ ಬಾರೆ ಬಾರೆ ಚಂದದ ಚೆಲುವಿನ ತಾರಿ ಒಲವಿನ ಚಿಲುಮಿಗೆ ಚೆಲುವಿನ ತಾರೆ ಬಾರೆ ಬಾರೆ ಒಲವಿನ ಚಿಲುಮೆಯ ತಾರೆ ಕೈಬಳೆ ನಾದದ ಗುಂಗನು ಅಳಿಸಲಾರೆ ಮೈಮನ ಸೋಲುವ ಮತ್ತನು ಮರೆಯಲಾರೆ ಕೈಬಳೆ ನಾದದ ಗುಂಗನು ಅಳಿಸಲಾರೆ ಮೈಮನ ಸೋಲುವ ಮತ್ತನು ಮರೆಯಲಾರೆ ರೂಪ ಸಿರಂಭೆಯ ಸಂಗವ ತೊರೆಯಲಾರೆ
Welcome back. You're tuned into 101.3 FM Rainbow's Inspire with me, Rashmi Shetty. On the hot seat today is Dr. Meenakshi Bharath. Really interesting to talk to, a gynecologist and social activist. So my question next to you is, what as parents today, parents face grooming problems? Options still remain engineering, medicine, or any of the technological sides wherein they are lucrative, they bring back money. Very few parents groom their children or show an option of politics or being a leader in a country as an option. And you have moved into that area from the most lucrative profession of being a gynecologist. You surprise me, doctor.
I think that all of us who have, three square meals a day and a good house, we need to
tell our children that there are options that are available that always do not require you to earn money. Yes, earn some amount of money, but don't kill yourself. Don't burn yourself on both sides of the candle by lighting it so that you are burnt out by 35, 40. To me, both my children have taken up, not the run-of-the-mill. My daughter is a counseling psychologist and she works with autistic children. And when I see her, she has so much joy in, helping a child clap their hands or letting the child make a paper bag or something like that. And my son has taken up to doing environmental sciences. And I think we have to encourage our children to go off the beaten track, allow them the passion for their profession, whatever they would like to do. As parents, we must not insist on our children doing what is our unfulfilled dream. So we must let go and allow them to do, because...
But isn't letting go so difficult?
I don't know. I didn't find it difficult at all. When my daughter said that, Mom, I don't want to become a doctor. I want to be anything but a doctor. And so did my son. I said, all right, whatever drives your passion, as long as you study well, as long as you put in your extra mile into whichever line that you are, I'm fine. And maybe God has been very fortunate. My grandfather gave me the house that I live in.
Okay.
Maybe those are all the perks that give me the advantage of saying, go ahead and do what you like. And there is always a meal and a roof over your head.
Yes.
So that's something that I do. I still believe that we must inspire our children to get into all these administrative and political fields, because by abdicating our position in this, we've actually allowed people without professional qualifications to come into this very important field, because both the administration and the political circles actually define how life in India is moving. And if over the last 30 years politics has become a downhill process and everybody says politics is dirty, don't get into it, why must you get into it? I think we need to understand that we have left that space empty, and therefore it's got filled up by people who have come in only for their personal gain. We got to stop it. Get people come in and say, we must get into this profession, bring professionalism into it, and make it a noble profession what it was at the time of independence. Even though people say that, the first corruption thing happened in 1948, all that is fine. But somewhere we have to drive this out. The public good is more important than the personal good. And why am I getting into politics? Because I believe that that drives my passion now. And that is a space that I would like to occupy. Because being in that space, I will be able to do good for hundreds of people. As a gynecologist, it brings me great joy to help a couple have that baby that they have been having difficult to get in. But it's only a family that I can affect at one point of time. If I get into this public space, which I'm already into, and I'm only aspiring to be to stand for the MLA of Malleshwaram, purely because I believe that in that hot seat, I can do far more good than I have been doing so far. Because every time we reach some particular point, there is a stumbling block, there is no political will, and then, you're left with your hands empty. So I think that I'm no less than anybody else to aspire to become the MLA. And in this case, I'm standing in my area.
Okay, so then in that case, doctor, people receive a lot of flack when they get into politics. They see so much of stumbling blocks. You have never seen all of them that you feel that it's okay, I'm going to give it a shot?
Well, starting from the first stumbling block, my parents turned around and told me, what's wrong with you? My husband keeps saying, I don't think you should do this, but... My parents and my parents-in-law and my husband and my children have been supporting me, having understood that, I'm not going to veer away and come back and be just a housewife or a wife or a mother.
they've now come to realize that, you know, I better support her. She's not going to change. So it's much nicer. They give me immense support. And I thank them for the support that they give. But I believe that, you know, all of us must, my generation must give the foundation for better politics and better politicians to come in, who are leaders who will work selflessly. Because after all, where is everybody going to take the money that they're stashing away? Are they all going to become Tutankhamuns? You know, you will have a grave full of lovely things, but it's a grave, you know. I don't think, and they're not even carrying that. I mean, they will. And in the bargain, I believe that they are, you know, helping to spoil their children and their next generation, because they've got too much of money. And so they don't have any reason to actually work. They go into, you know, different bad habits. I think it is absolutely necessary that we make good citizens of our children, and that they become responsible citizens of India and drive India to a better future. And I look forward to every young person, because 60% of the population is below 35 years. I think all of you must plug in. Instead of plugging out of India and out of politics, all of you must plug in into your neighborhood, work for your neighborhood, and make it a better place to live in. And now elections around the corner. Folks, 18 years and above, check your name on the voters list, put your name on the voter, cast your vote. Choose a leader who inspires you, and come on, let's all work together to make not only a better Bangalore, but a better Karnataka and a better India. I think each one of us must add our little mite to make it absolutely fantastic for us.
But don't you feel people around us have become pretty skeptical about what is happening, sarcastic about the way things are working, and everybody has that expression on their face when you talk leadership, as in, yeah, okay, so this one's going to go and a worse one's going to come. Do we have much of a choice?
We will, if people who are professional. So I'm asking, among women, I say, all right, you know, study, get married, have your two children, take care of them till they're 15, 16, because it's our responsibility to take care of our children. Mm. I mean, some of the women may turn around and say she's not being feministic, but I believe that it is our responsibility to do good by our children. Let them be 20, 22. Once they're standing on their own feet, come out, man. That's the time that you are the best. And instead of sitting in the shell and in your house and looking at the television, watching those TV programs that don't move forward at all, the story never moves forward, come out, let's help each other, let's help other women to become independent, to have an earning capacity. Every woman should have the ability to earn, because when she earns, she will actually help the rest of her family, and she'll never ever deny her family the money. She must have, and she must not be in a position where she must ask for, you know, give me money from the husband to say, can I buy a kerchief? You must have the independence to earn, and you have the ability to earn. So every woman must do something for her to earn, whether she is just doing upinkai, or whether she is making papads, or she is doing embroidery in the house. If she can't leave the house, do these things which you can do at home. And if not, well, empower yourself to do something outside your house, because only if you earn money do you get any, you know, credit. Being a housewife, you could be working from morning till night, but you don't get any credit. And even though there have been efforts now to say even a housewife must be given income, who gives? So if you bring in income into your house, then you actually have a better standing. So for women, I want to empower them to make them capable of earning, and therefore capable of taking care of their family better, of their husbands better, of their in-laws better. I think all of us women must rally around each other. So the other message that I would like is that, you know, remember, age catches up with you very fast. I mean, Saas bhi kabhi bahu thi is one of my favorite words. And I was a bahu the other day, and I'm very soon going to become a Saas. So when you become a Saas, take care of your bahu nicely, because
Abhi, if you do not take care of her and set up a nice example and, you know, establish that bond of love, then later on you will end up regretting, because she will only do a duty by you. You're not going to be young, beautiful and healthy all the time. Soon that is going to catch up with you. And when you're not healthy, that's when the time you need your children and your daughters-in-law or whatever.
Mm.
And at that point, you must, you know, they must do the taking care with love and not out of a responsibility. So,
okay.
Something for women to think about.
Yes, yes, definitely.
Be a good mother-in-law from the beginning.
Okay, and start off by being a good daughter-in-law.
Yes.
Your next song on the playlist is from the film Suffer. Any reason why you wanted Jeevan Se Bari Tere Aankhe?
I think in this picture it was, you know, somebody who loved a person very much.
Hmm?
But when they found that, you know, they couldn't live all their lives with them, they actually gave up that love, because Rajesh Khanna as the person wanted to give Sharmila a long, beautiful life.
Right.
And he was willing to sacrifice his love for her. And this was the time where, you know, the movie is, I must have seen it a dozen times. I'm a great fan of the Rajesh Khanna of the 70s.
Okay.
And we were all part of the little team that got disappointed when he married Dimple Kapadia. But doesn't matter. I think I loved him for the actor that he was, for the presence that he gave. And when he died recently, all my cousins, all my friends wrote to me and said, you know, my condolences to you because Rajesh Khanna died. For them, Rajesh Khanna was synonymous with Meenakshi in the school days.
Wow. So on that beautiful note, we listen to this track from Suffer.
जीवन से भरी तेरी आंखें मजबूर करें जीने के लिए सागर भी तरसते रहते हैं तेरे रूप का रस पीने के लिए जीवन से भरी तेरी आंखें तस्वीर बनाए क्या कोई लिखे तुझ पे कविता रंगों छंदों में समाएगी किस तरह से इतनी सुंदरता एक धड़कन है तू दिल के लिए एक जान है तू जीने के लिए जीवन से भरी तेरी आँखें सुगंध है सांसों में बाहों में कमल की कोमलता किरणों का तेज है चेहरे पे हिरणों की है तुझ में चंचलता आंचल का तेरे है तार बहुत कोई चाक जिगर सीने के लिए मजबूर करें जीने के लिए, जीने के लिए जीवन से भरी तेरी आंखें।
Fascinating journeys, inquisitive travelers, motivating stories. Interested? Tune in to Inspire every second and fourth Saturday at 7 p.m. on 101.3 FM Rainbow. Welcome back. You're tuned into Inspire with me, Rashmi Shetty, and our guest this evening, Dr. Meenakshi Bharath. Doctor, you told us that it's important we move into the public space. For somebody who hasn't ever ventured out, how do I start? Where do I start?
You start with getting to know your neighbors.
Okay.
You start with knowing your people in the street. You start with working with them to plug in.
Mm-hmm.
And as you do, you will come across people who need your help, who need your care. And then from there, you form a nice little group of your community. And then you become a resident welfare association. And then you start working with the government authorities, the BBMP. And you just start climbing. The moment you start working beyond yourself, you will find that people will come together with you, rally around you, and start looking up to you for help. And that is how we start. There are resident welfare associations everywhere. Find who is the resident welfare association in your area and just join them and work with them. There are so many problems that we are all facing, and an extra stick in the broom would help. To a very great extent.
Very true.
So what we are saying is, we want you to become a neighborhood locality wherein you participate in what is happening in the neighborhood. We want the locals to have their first say, that there is a decentralized governance. Unless we demand of our politicians and our local authorities, they don't give anything. We need to demand, like a good teacher demands performance from their students. It is the teacher who actually transforms you, and a strict teacher is somebody who really cares for you and makes you become a better person. The same way, we as citizens need to demand of our public servants better performance. Because we don't demand anything, they don't give anything. So that is there. We also need to bring in a merit system in the government, in the civil services, wherein merit is recognized. Currently, no merit is recognized. So all the highly capable people get very demotivated because, you know, somebody else with lesser ability gets a better job. So then they get completely demotivated. So that's one thing that we need to do. And we also need to have quick and even-handed justice for everybody. So it shouldn't be that because I'm a poor person, even if I have something going wrong with me, that I'm scared to go to the police station because the police will not listen to me. So there must be even justice that is there. So each one of us must empower the disempowered, and also, like a doctor, I think health is very important, and that's the most neglected feature.
Mm-hmm.
People will come to me and say, give me a discount. First of all, I hardly charge anything. Uske upar discount pe puchte hain. So I said, when you go to that Kanchivaram shop, do you actually ask for a discount? No, you don't. So put health on a priority. Do prevention, better than cure. And really, my mission in life is to provide better health for the community. So if that can happen, that is really fantastic.
Oh, wow. Okay. In fact, when you were talking about all this, what I was thinking is, if you're given, let's say, 3 minutes now, what would be the one thought that crosses you when you're looking back at the journey that you've taken so far to where you've come today? How would you describe the journey?
I think it's a journey of discovery, that there is a strength in you that you never knew, that there is an ability in you
to look beyond yourself that most of us don't even recognize. Mm. And once we recognize that, if we hone those skills, then you bring a lot of joy to others, and that joy then gets translated onto yourself. So when you get up in the morning, you get up with a zeal. What can I do to make life better for everybody around you? And everything works like that. You know, I started doing garbage management. I manage my wet waste in my house. I have avocados that look like full-scale coconuts. That means even the trees are so happy with the little extra care that I am giving that they are producing such good fruits. The birds are there. We've got to understand that as human beings, we need to look beyond ourselves. There is nature that we need to take care of. And if we nurture it for a little while, the nature will take care of you for hundreds of years. Unfortunately, we start becoming so greedy, you know, that we are willing to kill nature, not understanding one day that it'll lash back at us like a tsunami. So I really think each one of us must take care of the environment, of the nature around us. And
so there are no mornings, Dr. Meenakshi, where you get up and you're like, oh God, what am I doing?
No.
Never has been.
Never. What is it that I can do now? And it starts with, you know, making the cup of tea, and I'm already out in the garden to see what my plants are saying to me. And it is such a joy. I never knew this because I lived in the Middle East for, you know, many years. But even in the Middle East, I did take care of my garden and the petunias that grow there. So somewhere this has always been dormant. It's now come out in the open. It's now very, very evident that nature is something that we need to take care of. And everybody around us.
Wow. Okay. So you had an inspiration for sure. But I'm sure you too have your motivators. So flip side to this interview, the fun element. The one book or movie that you would recommend to everybody you meet.
Two new movies that I saw. One is The Inconvenient Truth by Al Gore. Okay. And I think Al Gore did a great job, more than being the vice president, by putting this movie up. He put up a great thing. And the other one was a new little cartoon that was called The Lorax. Mm. I think maybe all of you should see it. It's great fun as to how one little young girl goes chasing for a seed of a tree. I thought those were two very nice things.
Okay, and no particular book that you would recommend? The movies would be good enough.
I am all hands-on person.
Okay.
I'm not good. A book reader at all, though. Okay. Everybody tells me read this book and that book.
Okay. Your favorite teacher?
Two people. One is my school teacher called Mary Fernandez, who I always knew, I always cared, I always came back to her in the 25 years that I was out of Bangalore. But when I came back and I had organized a farewell party for her, and everybody came back and we got a little book written with tributes to her, that's when I realized that she actually transformed my life from a, you know, not so capable person in ninth standard. She completely transformed me, made me really a perfectionist, and I then became a head girl in 10th standard. In 9th, I had no potential for any leadership. And she transformed me, and I believe she transformed hundreds of girls over the 38 years that she was a teacher in wow. Cluny Convent. So hats off to her. Mm. I have my doctor, Dr. A. Rajshekar, who was my guide when I was doing my MD, and he was another inspiration for me. He was again a perfectionist, believed in reading and knowing, and he really taught very well. And he, even when he developed cancer and he was giving treatment, he was teaching the the nurses to put the IV drips better. And I also have my aunt who inspired me to become a doctor, Dr. Premlata. And she's also another person who is a perfectionist. So maybe somewhere down the line, I'm a half perfectionist.
Okay, that's pretty humble. Your role model?
Today, my role model is Arvind Kejriwal. Okay. Somebody who is willing to stake his life to do good for the country, for the community. I think he's one of those who is really brave, very tough personally, and a very simple man. I went to pick him up when he came in December of 2010, when we started the SACO corruption campaign in Bangalore. And there was this simple man in a kurta and a pant with a
ordinary suitcase in his hand, waiting for me at Makri Circle to pick me up. I said, I'll come to the airport to pick you. He said, no, don't waste your time. I'll come by bus and you can pick me up from here. I think those are the sort of leaders that we need for India today, who are willing to go the extra mile, who are very strong, who are very brave, and who will do good, making, you know, enormous personal sacrifices themselves.
Your best friend?
Over the last 7 years, I have come across this very pretty lady by the name of Mrs. Vani Murthy. And when I talk about love for a mother-in-law, she actually completely personifies the daughter-in-law that you would love to have. And okay. She has her mother-in-law who is now having Alzheimer's, and oh, you must see the love that she, with which she takes care of her. I think her mother-in-law is blessed to have somebody like her. And she's been always a staunch supporter of everything. We've done lots of things, from voter list corrections to garbage management to lots of things together. Even though we don't meet very often, there is some kinship that is there, and she has made a major impact in my life now.
Wow. Okay. The one quality that you're proud of that you have?
I think the determination to go the extra mile is what I'm very happy that I'm willing to do things with passion.
And okay.
Do things for others. Ask me and I will be there for you.
Oh, that's a big promise. But then, listening to your entire journey, Dr. Meenakshi, the one thought that came to me was what Uta Hagen had said some time back, that we must overcome the notion that we must be regular. It robs you of the chance to be extraordinary and leads you to the mediocre. I think you're somebody who lives by this and wants to walk that extra mile to be extraordinary and make a difference. Honor to have spoken to you.
Thank you very much. I'm honored to be here, and I'm also honored that you say that I inspire you. I just want to be a role model for the younger generations, so that they can climb on my shoulders and do far more than what I can do. So come in, join, be part of the political system and make a difference. Each one of you can contribute to a better India. And I think each one of you can contribute to just be the change that you want to see.
That's so true. A powerful parting thought. And if they want to get in touch with you, can we have your contact details?
Yeah, you can get me on email at Dr. Meenakshi, DrMeenakshi, 4, MLA at gmail.com. And my Facebook page is Meenakshi for Malleshwaram. And if you would like to send me a message or call me up, my number is 8970-500-500.
Okay, I'll repeat for those who have a problem like me to take it down slowly. The email ID would be Dr. Dr. Meenakshi, MEENAKSHI, 4MLA at gmail.com. And the phone number, 8970-500-500. Got it right?
And yes. The Facebook page is Meenakshi for Malleshwaram.
Okay, Meenakshi.
Since everybody is now so very, cyberspace-clued into Facebook.
Okay. Thank you very much, Dr. Meenakshi. Pleasure speaking to you. And you. The last song on the list, Country Roads. Any special reason why you wanted Country Roads?
I think it says Country Roads, take me home. And I want every Indian to come back to India, because India is this place to be in. And put in your bit. So come back. We need you.
Okay. So that was Dr. Meenakshi Bharath on Inspire Today. Time for me, Rashmi Shetty, to sign off. I'll see you at 10:02 on Meethi Yaade. But between 10:02 and 10:30, we have a live update from Goa on the film festival. So 10:30 is when I'll take over with Meethi Yaade. Shridev, take over after FM Sudhi.
Take me home. Around her, mine is left.
in my eyes run zero. Calls me.